Sunday, November 7th. I know that we might not have a full house yet because we all lost an hour of sleep last night. But we did it. We gained an hour. So where are you people? You're here, and I love it. Dave was here early for Sunday school, so we got a double dose of Sunday school. He's usually with us on Tuesdays. it's a beautiful morning, and it really is wonderful to have everybody gathered here with us. Zane, thank you for going to get Gus. I appreciate that. I heard Gus was adjusting to the time change as well. And you know, when you're growing older, you have to adjust as well, your expectations and such. But before we begin worship, I have a few announcements to share. First, I want to welcome Donna Robertson and invite her to share our call to offering today. She has a special message for everyone that has something to do with these blank cards. So don't write on them yet unless the Spirit compels you. If it does, then go ahead. But she will explain what these are for when the time comes. Also, other announcements. This coming Saturday is our holiday arts and crafts show from 9 a.m. to 4 p.m. I know a lot of people have been working hard on their crafts. It is a wonderful event. It's a great time to get your Christmas shopping done because you can support the local artisans in the church, and you can also get your holiday shopping done at the same time, and you can say, I know the artist. The other announcement that I want to make is that on Sunday, November 21st, so not next Sunday, but the Sunday afterwards, is our second annual congregational meeting. That is the meeting that we will vote on church officers for this next year. Church officers being the deacons and the ruling elders of the church. And so that will happen after church. And then the deacon's soup luncheon is at that time too, right, Linda? Okay, yes. We will also have the deacon's soup luncheon at that time as well. As far as prayer concerns go, please keep Mickey Shanklin and Joanna Shanklin in your prayers. Joanna's mother, Irene Hopton, passed away last week. And so please keep them in your prayers. Are there any other announcements that anyone wishes to lift up or share? First, Vicki.
The Christmas basket is getting ready to fall. Marchers will have the sign-up sheet for phone calls. It is the 6th through the 9th, I think, 4 days we have someone signed up for it. There will be the 9 to 11 and 11 to 1. So we need 8 sign-ups. Rushing out the door this morning, I forgot to bring this sheet, but I'll try to get it to Sylvie this week. Just let her know if
thank you, Vicki. And that is to sign up to take phone calls, correct?
Correct.
Okay, good. Yes, Portia.
My brother has been transferred to Worcester Hospital Transitional Care and Rehab. And today is my wonderful sister-in-law, Karen Finch's birthday.
Happy birthday, Karen. She's so excited for the attention. That's really good news about Eric, though, and we will continue to pray for him that he gets stronger, and that's a good birthday gift, for sure. Yes, Cindy.
I just want to let you know my brother-in-law, Rick Cooper, is now back home from, he's been in the hospital with pneumonia, and he's gone back in, but he's actually back home now and doing somewhat better. He's still struggling.
Okay, we will we'll keep him in our prayers for sure. It's good to hear that he is back home as well. Anyone else? At this time, I invite you to join with me in our call to worship. So stand up, stretch out, greet the morning, and I will read the parts of Psalm 8 that are not in bold, and also the bold parts, but join with me in reading the parts in bold as we read together Psalm 8, the Psalm of David. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory in the heavens. Through the praise of children and infants, you have established a stronghold against your enemies to silence the foe and the avenger. When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you have set in place, what is mankind that you are mindful of them? Human beings, that you care for them. You have made them a little lower than the angels and crowned them with glory and honor. You made them rulers over the works of your hands. You put everything under their feet. All flocks and herds and the animals of the wild, the birds in the sky and the fish in the sea, all that swim in the paths of the sea. Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. And now join with me in singing hymn number 325 in our green hymnals. All hail the power of Jesus. Now is the time as we enter worship and enter God's holy presence that we know the ways that we can be holy, that we know the ways that we have fallen short, and that we admit to God the ways we have fallen short of this holiness, because that is God's desire for us, to be glorified in Christ. And God sent Jesus because God knows that we cannot get there alone by sheer power of our will. That is where Jesus' grace comes in. And so acknowledging this, now is the time where we acknowledge our own shortcomings and our own sin to the Lord. And first, I invite you to join with me in saying our prayer of confession together. And these are common sins that are common to society. And so please join with me in saying our prayer of confession. Almighty God, judge of creation and author of life, we are gathered this morning to humble ourselves before your grace, your discipline, your truth, and your vision of what is to come. We admit that too often we have been deceived when it comes to the matter of your truth, and when it comes to the truth about ourselves and the lives we live. There are times when we have hidden the truth, or even lied, in order to save face or escape the judgment of others. We fear being hurt physically and spiritually, and are too willing to sacrifice truth and faith, character and courage, in order to avoid this pain. Forgive us for this way we might stumble in sin, as we now confess our most personal sin to you alone in silence. The Apostle Mark writes in his Gospel, and when you stand praying, if you hold anything against anyone, forgive them so that your Father in heaven may forgive you of your sins. Remember this command whenever you pray so that you can let go of any vengeful frustration that you might harbor towards others that might stain your heart and take over your thoughts so you may focus your heart and your thoughts and your mind on God's grace and God's glory and sharing that with others. Now join with me in singing to God's eternal presence with the words of the Gloria Patri, just as they were sung in the church of old.
Endurance.
Good job. That's right. Endurance. Now, do you know what that means? Okay, endurance means if you hurt. Gus, are you hurt? Does your boo-boo hurt? Endurance means you can get through that, even if it hurts. Now, what helps you get through that? Do you know it's going to feel better? Gus, do you think your boo-boo's going to feel better?
Yeah,
that's right. What helps boo-boos feel better?
Band-aids.
Band-aids, they help, definitely. Medicine helps. Helper penguins help. If any of you need to know what a helper penguin is, it's an ice pack that's in the shape of a penguin.
and what else does that?
Yes, that's right. You know what helps the most is time. After time, you start to feel better, right? Because your body's growing and healing. Well, you are going to hear a story in junior church today about a man who endured a lot. He had lots of endurance. Now, this started when he was a little baby and his mom wanted to protect him, and because there were bad men looking for him. And so she put him in a basket and sent him down the river. Do you know who this might be? Gus, do you know? His name was Moses. Oh, we're looking at ourselves on TV again? Okay. All right. Okay. His name was Moses. And he taught the people of Israel about endurance. Can you say endurance?
Endurance.
Good, that's right. They had to endure and get through a lot of ways where they were hurt or uncertain. Can you pray with me now about endurance and healing? Let's pray. Lord, thank you so much for giving us time to heal, for giving us a spirit of endurance, for giving us those things that help us heal like band-aids, and especially time. Love of those around us. Lord, it is in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Yeah. Thank you. Okay, I think Miss Tammy's teaching today. We will keep Tammy and the kids in our prayers later today as well. I hope that is reciprocated. It's an important lesson for all of us, though, and we have to experience it more often than we might want to. And part of this is reflected in our first scripture lesson today. This comes from Psalm 103, verses 13 to 22. As a father has compassion on his children, so the Lord has compassion on those who fear him. For he knows how we are formed. He remembers that we are dust. The life of mortals is like grass. They flourish like a flower of the field. The wind blows over it, and it is gone. And its place remembers it no more. But from everlasting to everlasting is the Lord's love with those who fear him, and his righteousness with their children's children, with those who keep his covenants and remember to obey his precepts. The Lord has established his throne in heaven, and his kingdom rules over all. Praise the Lord, you his angels, you mighty ones who do his bidding, who obey his word. Praise the Lord, all his heavenly hosts, you his servants who do his will. Praise the Lord, all his works everywhere in his dominion. Praise the Lord, my soul. This is a holy wisdom and a holy word. Our second scripture lesson comes from Luke's Gospel, chapter 12, verses 8 to 10. And it again talks about the importance of praising God, but in a very specific way. And it again talks about fearing the Lord, but in a very specific way. And this is from Jesus' teachings. Jesus said, I tell you, whoever publicly acknowledges me before others, the Son of Man will also acknowledge before the angels of God. But whoever disowns me before others will be disowned before the angels of God. And everyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven. But anyone who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven. This is a holy wisdom and a holy word.
Thanks be to God.
There's a lot in those three verses, four verses from Luke's Gospel. Three that I read. There's a lot in there. And Jesus talks about the importance of public witness. And then, although he says those will be disowned who do not admit that, anyone who speaks a word against the Son of Man will be forgiven. But anyone who blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven. Jesus' whole ministry stressed the importance of forgiveness. And this stretched far beyond Jesus' earthly ministry. He gave his life on account of forgiveness. And he talked about the extremity of this forgiveness numerous times. And one of the most important times is from Matthew's Gospel, Matthew 18:22. Jesus affirms that we forgive someone who harms us not just once, not just seven times, but 77 times. Or seven times 77. Or seven times 70, depending on your translation. But really, that part doesn't matter so much, because if you are still counting after 77 times, I think you're missing the point. That's kind of impressive to a certain degree. When we live in a society where it's three strikes and you're out, 77 seems pretty graceful. Even seven seems graceful. So, Jesus teaches forgiveness. But why, in this section of Matthew's Gospel, is Jesus teaching about something that is not forgivable? He teaches about not a sin that is unforgivable, but rather who that sin is against. A sin against the Holy Spirit will not be forgiven. Jesus says even those who transgress against the Son of Man will be forgiven, but not against the Holy Spirit. What is this? What does that mean? This is some of the harshest words that Jesus speaks. It has sparked much debate in church circles, and I admit, I'm not going to be able to stand up here and make a list of all of the sins against the Holy Spirit, and as long as we avoid those, we're good. Kind of be nice, no? But one of the best definitions as to what this might be, how this might be avoided, actually does not come from an unorthodox source. It comes from a very orthodox source. The Russian Orthodox source. So very, very orthodox, to be precise. From Father Seraphim Slavovskoy, who wrote the following in his catechism, The Law of God. It was written around the 1915, I want to say. Around that time. And he writes, Jesus Christ, called the Holy Spirit, Spirit of Truth, in John 14:17, 15:26, 16:13, and warned us, all matter of sin and blasphemy shall be forgiven unto men, but the blasphemy against the Holy Spirit shall not be forgiven unto men. Matthew 12:31. Blasphemy against the Holy Spirit is conscious and hardened in opposition to the truth, because the Spirit is truth. 1 John 5:6. conscious and hardened resistance to the truth leads man away from humility and repentance. It comes from a Russian Orthodox catechism, or teaching, or doctrine, as we talked about in Sunday school today. But it does get to the truth and an underlying truth of the matter, and that is the recognition of the Holy Spirit as the Spirit of truth, and conscious opposition to that is extremely dangerous, and is so dangerous that it might endanger the soul, not just the body. And I stress the word conscious opposition, because there are plenty, yours truly included, that might sin in ignorance, that might not know what the truth is. But once you know what the truth is, and once your heart convicts you of that truth, and you specifically lie consciously and continue to do so, it's very dangerous. Now, this morning I want to understand the importance of recognizing the truth and then proclaiming the truth in Christ. And I will begin where it is most understandable and tempting to lie. Where I would say I would give someone quite a bit of leeway if they happen to lie under these circumstances. And that is, if they were facing the very real threat of bodily persecution, not just to themselves, but especially to those whom they love. I can understand forgiving this circumstance. But Jesus himself, in this passage, in this section of Luke, was talking about a very persecuted church. He knew that his followers are being persecuted and were going to be persecuted more heavily as history went on. In just a few verses earlier, in 12:4, he says, "I tell you, my friends, do not be afraid of those who kill the body and after that can do no more. But fear the one who can destroy not just the body, but the soul. The Lord is the only one that can do that. But the devil can do that if you allow the devil to do that sort of work." And the reason why I bring up this very bodily persecution first is because this is what would cause us to betray our convictions most openly, is if we are threatened physically, when we are physically scared for ourselves and our being. Public acknowledgement of Jesus at that time in his context was very dangerous and is still very dangerous in certain parts of the world. It is something that people want to hide because of very real world consequence. And Jesus acknowledges and stresses the importance of publicly acknowledging him as the Christ, though, when he continues to minister. "I tell you, whoever publicly acknowledges me before others, the Son of Man will also acknowledge before the angels of God. But whoever disowns me before others will be disowned before the angels of God." There's a call to retain public witness, the importance of proclaiming Jesus as the Christ amidst that sort of persecution. This is still true to this day. And the importance of public courageous proclamation, even when it might harm your body, is the most powerful witness. But that is also not our context that we live into every day today. If we look at our own context in America today, this persecution that might bring us to abandon the truth or lie to ourselves is very different. The more dangerous persecution that we might face is against the truth, is allowing us to betray the truth, and the persecution that we might face that might destroy our sin or allow us to turn our backs on Jesus is much more slow-moving often. It's much more unexpected. It's much more insidious, subtle. And we're going to get to that soon, what that wear and tear does to us. But first, I want to talk about the temptation to destroy the truth or to go against the truth. How many of you sitting here in the pews have ever lied before? Consciously. Oh, thank you for raising your hands. And those who didn't, stop lying. It happens. And so what does this mean? That we all sin against the Holy Spirit and there is no hope for us? No, that's not the purpose of this. The point is to say that lying or hiding the truth is a very human thing. Now, how many times do you think, when you remember what you lied about, first of all, was it worth it? And second of all, was it even important? Maybe. Maybe not. Did you lie to avoid consequence? Or more importantly and more commonly, did you lie to save face? See, there's a very important notion in this, and Max Anders writes in the book that we are going through, 30 Days to Understand the Bible, when he talks about the doctrines and talks about specifically Satan and the great adversary of God. He writes that in the Bible, Satan is called the deceiver and destroyer. He deceives in order to destroy. A primary strategy is to make that which is wrong look right and that which is right look wrong. And how does Satan go about this most effectively? By using human beings. And not just single human beings, but groups of people. Because I cannot tell you how easy it is for people to be deceived because they face pressure from a group of people. And it starts at a very, very early age. How many in school have heard the term peer pressure? Or wanting to please those around you, to be accepted into the group? So often, when people betray a truth that they feel in their hearts, it is because they want to be accepted by other people and loved by other people. They want to know that other people are on their side, that they have their back, and that they can be a part of something bigger. And the truth can be betrayed as a result. So that's the first danger that we face today. And this danger is one that is consistently increasing as people find their own groups, find their own truth within those groups, and harden up and calcify, and point the finger to others, but don't look at their own sins in the mirror. Very easy. And the easiest thing to grab someone's attention, what is that? Something that offends you or makes you angry. It's almost impossible to ignore. If somebody dropped a cup of coffee and there was a puddle of coffee sitting, staining the ground right here in worship, I would have a very difficult time not staring at that stain. And if you all could see it, I'm sure that is true as well. It is hard not to focus on what is wrong. The problem with that is it's not often found in a mirror to the soul. So there's a temptation to reject truth in general in order to fit in. And then once that starts to gain traction, then your eyes might become clouded and you might not be able to see it. And we'll get to ways to combat this and push against this later from Scripture. But there's another temptation that is even deeper, to reject the temptation to reject Jesus as the Christ, the temptation to reject Jesus as the Christ. Essentially, the temptation to lose your faith. And this one can be a little bit different. One way to do so is absolutely peer pressure and absolutely being surrounded by people who might say your faith is ridiculous and there are many reasons to doubt it. That can happen. And I think one reason why churches stress cordoning themselves off from the world is to protect people from exposure to people who might have that belief. Which I get, but is also dangerous because how are you supposed to be strong in your own faith and reach them? So that's one way of doing it. But the other thing that I see more commonly, that I've seen and witnessed from members of this church who had been members, is if something happens in their life that reveals God's grace in this world, in this context, might seem limited. Where there is a shock to the system, where the life we once lived, full of blessings, was turned into something far more challenging. And this can happen all at once, through a stroke or a heart attack or a sudden death, or it can happen much more subtly, as our bodies break down, as the world faces challenges where we might seem isolated, where we have to endure a certain amount of pain, and then question, where is this good God that I have worshipped most of my life? Where are these good people from church? Why aren't they calling as much as I think they should? Why have I been abandoned? And I'm going to share this story with others if I hurt that much. Now, our own mortality is the main driver of this. Our fragile bodies that are so easily broken. And yesterday's service was a painful reminder that our lives are quite limited. There's a temporal nature to ourselves. But something happened during that service that reminded me where we are when we acknowledge God, when we call upon the presence of the Holy Spirit. Now, part of that service was to say, yes, our lives are limited, but God's love is eternal. And I'll tell you, doing that whole service and also during this service, that light right above Dolores and Justine keeps flickering. And my first thought is, Ken, you're right underneath the light. You know, you and Ron Hart could probably team up to fix that because you're light people. We're the trustees when you need them. but my second thought was this. There might be something more to this as well. That the world of the Spirit can influence our own as subtly and noticeably as shaking a loose filament. A vibration in the faintest of connections, an ability to tug on a loose strand of that veil that might separate the heavens and the earth. That just maybe there's an element of things that aren't quite right that communicate God's presence. Things that don't seem to quite fit where we are thinking. And it's a small and a minor occurrence, something maybe to look past, but we don't want to quench the Spirit. And we are in danger of quenching the Spirit if we only look to worldly ways for our health to improve or to be saved. If we think that the spiritual realm is far too distant, where the heavens are too far away and abstract to really strengthen our faith here and now. And if we are entrenched in that mindset, and that we can't see the wondrous and the heavenly realm breaking into our own, then we are in danger of losing faith when our own world starts to crumble. Now, here's our defense. This is where God's word comes into play. In 1 Thessalonians 5, 19-22, the Apostle Paul says, "Do not quench the Spirit. Do not treat prophecies with contempt, but test them all. Hold on to what is good and reject every kind of evil." When he writes this, "Do not treat the prophecies with contempt." The prophecies meaning something that you might not want to hear or might go against your comfort or worldview. Don't immediately dismiss them. At the same time, hold on to what is good and reject every kind of evil. Test the prophecies. It's something we all can do. Now, he also writes in Romans 12:2, "Do not conform to the pattern of this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will." Be open to what God's will is. Do not conform to the patterns of this world that pressure you into thinking one thing or saying one thing in order to please those around you. It is not about pleasing those around you. It is doing God's will. Jesus is the perfect example of that. And one scenario that is not really true in our context, but was very present right after Jesus died and was resurrected, and at the birth of the early church, we were talking about doctrine today in Sunday school class and the importance of certain doctrines, not to put pressure on people to believe a certain thing, but to teach what the truth has been as it has come down to through the church in the ages, to actually gain a rooting and an understanding of this that you can apply to your life. Not just something that says, "Well, this is the way it is, I told you so, that's it." It's to gain an understanding. Well, at the very beginning of the church, there were all sorts of different ideas and rumors out there as to who Jesus was. And one group was called the Gnostics. I think some of you might be familiar with the Gnostics. Some of you might not. But they thought that there was a secret knowledge and that Jesus was actually a spiritual being. He was completely spirit, that Jesus was part of that spirit, God's spirit, and that Jesus never suffered bodily at all because he wasn't human. And this sort of belief was spreading around the church, especially in John's community. The community that the Apostle John was evangelizing to. And so John wrote in his letter about the Antichrists, and those were, it's a little different than the Antichrist in Revelation, but the Antichrists being people who reject Jesus as the Christ and reject Jesus as a flesh and blood person. Jesus was a spirit with secret knowledge, and a certain group of people holds a secret knowledge, and only they can have it. So, with this context, John writes to the believers in 1 John 5:5-6, "Who is it that overcomes the world? Only the one that believes that Jesus is the Son of God. This is the one who came by water and blood, Jesus Christ. He did not come by water only, but by water and blood. And it is the Spirit who testifies, because the Spirit is the truth." This is a holy wisdom and a holy word.
Thanks be to God.
You have a lot in there. The Spirit is the truth. We've gone over that. But what is he talking about when it comes to water and blood? The beauty is a few different things. First, the water represents the forgiveness of sin, the baptism, and the blood is the sacrifice and the endurance of life. The water is the purity of Jesus' sinlessness. marked of his divine nature as the Son of God. This the Gnostic group acknowledged. Born of water, the purity of God's Spirit, but also born of blood. This is what they didn't acknowledge. The blood is a symbol of his human nature, that he was one who suffered pain and experienced death. And that is why it is with such irony that when we are born of his blood, we may be fully born again in the forgiveness granted by the purity of water again and again. It is this sacrifice of Jesus as a fully human being, experiencing pain undeserved, and it's a pain that we might too experience, that we might too not deserve. But we have an example. And in this way, we can wake up every morning, born anew, renewing our minds to the truth that only God holds. All the while, in the midst of this renewal, we always hold on to our own faith and hope forever that Jesus is the Christ, both as one who hurts the same way we do, and as the divine presence of purity and perfection in that humanity that can lead us closer to God, that can walk with us, that knows the same pain we feel, and knows how we can endure it and overcome it. Please join with me in singing hymn number 500 in our hymnals, Abide With Me. Thank you. may be seated. And at this time, I invite Donna forward to give us our call to giving.
What shall I give him, poor as I am? As a child in Sunday school, I learned to sing these words. The song's answer, I would do my part. I can give him my heart. This became a prayer throughout my life, asking, what have I to offer? To give to God, to the church, and to others. Whether personal, silent, or together, in worship, primary and essential is prayer when giving back to God and to the church. Prayer as a gift is the giving and receiving of a closer and more direct relationship with God. As Jesus taught his disciples, our Lord who art in heaven, we are able to ask in prayer, humbly, yet boldly, for our own needs, for others, and for the needs of this church. Energy given toward intentional prayer will bring life and energy to you. Time given to intentional prayer will hold for you a place in God's time, giving clarity, bringing abundance, realizing answers and possibilities beyond the request, making it possible to go beyond the current stated vision, mission, and purpose. Prayer is primary as an offering and a gift. And as a daily spiritual practice, you'll be amazed at how God answers your prayer. Give as you have received. So now at this time, take out that card you were given, and put a prayer request, and that will be brought forward today with the offering as a gift of love, of healing, whatever. It can be one word, it can be one name, it can be a mission of this church, it can be a whole sentence, but let's fill those in right now as we prepare to come forward. And now, as we come forward for the giving of gifts, also bring your prayer card with joy and enthusiasm, just like a child would their very first time, to be putting their offering, their gift, into the offering plate. And as you do that, you will have energy, you will be renewed, and I hope a smile on your face today, because we are cheerful and thankful givers. Thanks be to God.
Together in ways we might not expect, in a possibility that only you know, but that we are a part of, have a vision for, have engagement with. And Lord, We ask that you take these blessings. Bless us. Bless this community. And may your kingdom come. It is in the name of Jesus, through the power of the Holy Spirit, and the glory of the Father, that we pray for these things. Amen. Now rise and join with me in singing the doxology. In such a truth. Lord, we pray for your endurance when we experience hardship. Lord, we pray especially for the faith and hope needed to carry us through. And Lord, it is in this same faith and hope that we pray for those names and people specifically that we know need your strength and endurance to overcome trials. We lift their names up to you, both silently and out loud. Rick Hooper, Dwayne Hopp, Eric Kitch, Lord, bring your peace upon their hearts. Give them time to heal, and Lord, give us faith as we live this life one step at a time, moment by moment, and speak to our souls as we pray these words that your Son taught us to pray, praying now together, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And to close worship, I invite you to rise, and actually I'm going to switch up the hymns on us a little bit. We're going to sing hymn number 108, Rock of Ages, on account of our 1 John passage that was included in the sermon. Sing with me hymn 108, Rock of Ages.
Thank you.
us with these words from the Apostle Paul in Romans 8:38-39, encouraging us not to fear, despite talking about unforgivable sin. He writes this: "For I am convinced that neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future nor any powers, neither height nor depth nor anything in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Amen.